So, hi, Marit, and welcome to our podcast today.
Thanks, Ellie. I'm happy to have to be here in your podcast, and I feel honored.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, thank you so much. We're honored to have you here. It's really great, and I've been looking forward to speaking with you. So maybe just to start, you can tell us a bit about who you are and what you do for the people who aren't very familiar with you.
Yes, I'm Mariette Grothuus. I'm 32 years old. I'm from Holland. I'm a volleyball player, captain of the Dutch national team, and currently I play in Turkey for Aydın Büyükşehir Belediyesi. It's a difficult name. This is my second season here. And yeah, actually I played in almost all Europe in a lot of different countries. Yeah, this is my what I do for a living.
Awesome. That must be really cool now being in Turkey.
It's really, I feel really privileged and honored that I am able to do this kind of things to make from my hobby my profession.
Yeah, exactly. So, looking back at how it all started when you were just a kid, when and why did you start, playing volleyball?
Because it's a funny story. I actually started as a gymnastic.
Okay.
I did it for I think 2 years, gymnastic. Yes, and my sister played already volleyball, and my friends in school also, they started to play at 9, 10 years old, and I was thinking, okay, I cannot left behind. I also have to do this, you
Okay.
know. So I quit the gymnastic and I started to play volleyball with my friends from school, 1 or 2 times a week in the volleyball club, and yeah, it turned out I had some talent, and there it started. And I went to some like. Every Sunday to a volleyball school, we call it like this in Holland, that all the talents from the area come together and they practice together extra to get extra trainings hours to become better and better. Actually it went like this, and yeah, I'm not regretting my choice that I changed
Of
it.
course.
Yeah, it turned out pretty
Yeah, for
okay.
sure it did, looking back at it now.
Yeah.
But if you were doing gymnastics and everything, at one point when you grew up, you probably had to be like, okay, I need to choose, which one that I want to do. So, what was it then that made you want to do volleyball? Was it the fact that you had some talent or?
No, because we had like some rules in our home.
Okay.
My parents had 3 children, so everybody could play one sport. So they say like, okay, Marie, you have to choose, or you continue with gymnastics, or you play volleyball, but it's not both. This is not possible. I said, okay, mom, I want to quit and I want to play volleyball. So this was also easy because I felt really sometimes alone in the gymnastics.
Okay.
You know, it's like only you there out there, and I like this team things. I like to work together, and yeah, this was the choice what I made, and yeah, it's good.
Yeah, so you got to experience that more during, volleyball than gymnastics.
Oh, a lot,
Yeah.
especially volleyball. You know, it's so connected. It's so like if the reception is not good, the set has to be good, but it's like a minimum, like can be 2, 3 centimeter can make the difference, you know?
Yeah.
So this is really precise, and yeah, you need a lot of connection with your players, with your teammates.
Yeah, absolutely. And then at what age, after playing this for a while, at what age did you feel like, okay, this is what I want to do. I want to be a professional volleyball player. I want to do it for a living.
After 1 or 2 years, when I started, I was 9 years old. I wrote a letter to my grandmother, like my dream is to play in a Dutch national team and to play in Italy for a volleyball club. So I was 11. So at that time, this was really my dream, and I had really early this feeling that I can make this. Okay, people told me already like, okay, Mike, you have talent. Okay, you need more practice, but you have it. You have it in you. So it was pretty early that I think like, okay, if I have the chance, I want to make it like my profession.
Okay. So you were already kind of seeing that it was possible. It wasn't like, okay, this is a dream, we'll see. You were like, this is possible. I know I can make
This
it
is
there.
possible. This is possible. Yes, this is possible. And I knew it will not be easy. Also in that time, it was already like, okay, And Saturday night, sometimes the school, my friends at school had some parties, and I couldn't go because Sunday morning I had to practice. Mm-hmm. So, you know, and I'm the kind of girl who likes to party, who likes to have fun with the friends.
Yeah.
So this was already difficult, but okay, you know, I was thinking, okay, I really want this, so let's give it a shot. If it's not going to happen, it's not going to happen.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. that's super cool. And then obviously, you know, throughout your teenage years, you played volleyball in the Netherlands.
Yeah.
And then in 2008, you joined the Dutch national team, and that's when you made your first international debut with the national team. So what was that like for you? I believe you were 20 years old at that time.
Yeah. It was 2008, and mm-hmm. I was so nervous. I think I played my first match against Cuba. I'm not sure. And I came in the third set, something like this. And also I scored some points, but I was really surprised of. I was really honored because this was like, okay, I am now in a national team. Of course, mm-hmm. you know, not where I wanted to be, but at least I'm in a national team. But I was also really, really nervous. Really nervous. Yeah. This is so like, what is happening? And but my parents also say like to me, like, Maret, okay, you have this. Enjoy every moment. Because maybe next year you will not be in the team anymore. And I was trying to do that, you know. Like, okay, it's really an honor. I have the name of my parents on the back of my jersey. And this is so special. So, yeah. Directly, we made some pictures at home, of course.
Yeah.
When I got the jersey, everything, like, oh, this is so, yeah, this is good, you know.
Yeah.
But in 2008, because the team missed the Olympics at that time, so younger players get the chance to build mm-hmm. For the new team for 2012. So mm-hmm. actually, I was kind of lucky, it sounds bad, but they didn't make the Olympics. So they built already with new young players, and I was one of the young players. So I got a chance back then. And yeah. I stayed in the team for a while.
Yeah, exactly. That's what I was going to say. You said there that, oh, you don't know if I'm going to stay, you know, 1 year,
yeah.
a few years. But now it's been, you know, it's been 12 years and you're still representing the team. So, I mean, that's great. That's that's a really cool thing. So to be able to still represent your country today, you know, what does that mean to you at the highest level? Yeah.
A lot. Yeah. Okay, it's not always easy because we have a really busy schedule in the volleyball. It's like mm-hmm. from October till May, you have the club season. And from May till September, October, you have the international season with the national team. So sometimes you had 2 weeks holiday in 1 year. So your body and mentally, it's not always easy to perform, to be on that level all the time. But every time when I hear the national anthem of Holland, it's really like giving me goosebumps, and it's really cool, yeah, to be there. And especially when we play in Holland, of course, because all the public is singing together, and yeah, these moments I really appreciate, and yeah, it's really nice.
Yeah, that must be awesome, definitely. And like you said, especially playing at home, having the home crowd like helping you and singing everything. Must be a special feeling.
Yeah, and from 2015, we started to play good. We had the European Championship in Holland. We won a silver medal. And there were like 10,000 fans. This was a record for Holland, especially mm-hmm. volleyball. That was like, you want more, you want more, you want more, you know? It's like a kind of addiction. Like, okay, now I have 3 times silver. I want the gold medal, of course, you know. Okay, we will see.
Yeah, of course. Yeah, I mean, there are more chances, of course. So that's, you know, it's not
finished. I don't know, you know, also I have to be realistic because I'm 32 years old. Like, okay, I'm 180 centimeters. So it's not that I'm the biggest player. So I need my jump to attack. But my knees are not getting better, you know, so I have to make also some choices, like if I do still national team, club, like I have to think about it, because to do both, it's a lot. It's a lot for my body. Yeah,
like you say, to find a balance, because obviously if you go the whole year, that's a lot of training and lot of playing. Yeah,
and when you're 24 years old, okay, but now I start also to to feel when I wake up, okay, I don't recover as fast as before. So okay. I have to think about it. Yeah,
of course. And since 2015 as well, you're the, like you said before, the team captain of the national team.
Yeah, since 2013 I became the team captain.
Okay.
Yeah.
And is that something that, you know, before you became the captain, were you hoping for that? Is it something that you were expecting?
No, not expecting at all. Also, I was not hoping for that. Okay. Because in that time, we had also some really experienced players. And I think, okay, I'm not the one who's able to do that. But after 2012, some experienced players also quit. And the coach approached me for that. And at first, I had to think about it. Because it's not only to get the prize or the medal, or it's so much more. But also, I felt honored to be a captain of the national team. So, I spoke with my family about it. And they said, okay, if you're ready to it, don't underestimate it. Because it's really a lot what's coming on your plate. But yeah, if you feel good, do it. And I did it. And I never regret it. It was not easy, but I never regret it. Yeah.
But have you always seen yourself as someone who wanted to be in a captain role? Have you always felt like that was something you wanted to do, or that was just completely new when they first suggested it?
Nah, when I look at myself, like if I'm in a group of people, I'm like more like the natural leader. Okay. So it's not that people push me, but it's like this, people ask me, people, you know, look at me, like if something has to be happened. So... yeah, no, it was not like a goal, I want to be that. No, it happened. And yeah, it felt good at the time.
Yeah, of course. And how was it then in the beginning, I guess, to deal with all of these responsibilities, to deal with that type of role?
It was not easy.
Yeah,
it was not easy because you're like actually between the team and the coach. You know, like if you hear something in a team, if you hear something from the coach, you have to manage it and manage it in a good way. And some coaches are really open, but some coaches are really closed. So it's also difficult sometimes to work with that. But I learned that I have to stay true to myself and close to myself. And I also, you know, we have now also in the team, we have some players who are around the same age as me. So... when something happening, or I don't know, I ask them and we find a solution. Yeah.
So it was probably more in the beginning to kind of get into the role and see how everything would work.
It was really like looking like, okay, what can I do? What can I not do? Like, okay, maybe this is not so smart what I did. Okay, next time I have to approach it like in a different kind of way. Mm-hmm. So yeah, I learned a lot in this beginning.
Yeah. And then in 2016 as well, together with the Dutch national team, you competed at the 2016 Rio Olympics.
Yeah.
And that was the first time in 20 years that your women's team actually made the Olympics and you finished fourth in the end. So what was that experience like for you being at the Olympics with your team?
Finally, we were there, you know, after 20 years. So it was really such a cool feeling and to be with all the athletes in the village. Mm-hmm. And that I was walking in the village and Serena Williams was behind me and she started a conversation, you know, like, what is this, you know? So this was really like amazing. And we saw Djokovic and Nadal, it was really poor because he couldn't eat in the dining hall. Everybody wanted to make a picture with him. So these kind of things, like, really like around the volleyball, of course, it's really cool to experience. We were so close to win this medal. So it was really cool, but still feels a little bit bitter, you know, like we didn't take the medal home. Yeah,
that's what I wanted to ask, because obviously it's already, like you said, it's this great achievement, making it to the games, finishing fourth is a great, great finish. But do you think the fact that you were so close to the medal made it a bit, you know, like frustrating maybe to deal with?
Yeah. And especially the semi-final, because we played against China in the semi-final and we were killing them in the first set, really killing them. And in one moment we lost it. And this, I never saw the match back. I cannot, because really we could have won, you know. And if we win that match, you have a medal already. Mm-hmm. So this is the match what I'm most frustrated about. of course we look back like, okay, it was a really nice and fourth, we made history for the Dutch national women volleyball mm-hmm. team. But if you have a medal, it's like you have, there's so much more, you know. You can go to the king. You have like more entrances after. There's more possibilities. Now you had a really good tournament. But with a medal, it would have been perfect.
Okay, that was the last thing that you felt like.
Yeah.
Not maybe missed, but yeah, kind of going.
Yeah, for sure. The games. For sure.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And do you think that this impacted you, the time just after the Olympics, or how did you deal with maybe all of these different emotions coming home?
I felt so bad after the Olympics, okay. Really, like, because you are like in a bubble and the whole country is supporting you. You feel from everybody the support. And then you go, I think I was 1 week, 2 weeks at home. Mm-hmm. And then I left to Italy to my club. And I really had to adapt again. Like, okay, this is the normal life. Olympics is like the highest thing in our sport to accomplish. Like, and now I'm in the club, you know? Like, it was a little bit like, okay, back to reality. And that was not easy for me. I had a few months. Also, I spoke with other teammates, and almost everybody had the same feeling. Like, oh, it's so normal, you know? Mm-hmm. It's like daily life. And yeah, that was hard. Yeah.
Yeah, this is something we heard from a lot of athletes, actually, that the time after the Olympics, after, you know, all of that excitement leading up to it, like practice, everything, this big experience, and then you come back home and it's maybe a bit difficult to transition into normality, exactly. As you call it. Yeah.
Because your goal is so clear, mm-hmm. and everything is for the Olympics. And then after it's finished, it's like, yeah, and now what? And now what, you know?
Yeah.
And of course, we had the daily life again with the club. So for individual athletes, maybe it's more difficult. But yeah, that was a strange and difficult time. I never had it before, this feeling. Yeah.
Yeah. Not after any other competitions or like world championships. Or,
No, because yeah, this was something really special.
Special.
Yeah.
For sure. I can imagine.
Yeah.
And, you know, like you said before as well, aside from playing with the national team, you played for a lot of different clubs in different countries. First, you know, like we said, playing for the Netherlands until 2011. And then you've been to other countries like Italy, Azerbaijan, France, Poland, now in Turkey as well. So what has that been like for you to be able to, you know, travel so much and play for different teams in different countries, really?
Yeah, it's really sometimes like a roller coaster, you know? Because you're playing so, for 1 year you're so intensive with the coaching staff, with your teammates, and then the next year you have like totally different environment. You have to adapt again to a new country, a new culture. You don't know the way to the supermarket. You have to explore everything again. It was not always easy, but to be able to play with different cultures, to work in different countries, that teach me a lot. Like I'm sometimes joking to my family and friends, like, okay, if there's good internet connection, I can survive everywhere.
Yeah. <You know? laughs>
Really. And I also, Dutch people are a little bit like, we adapt easy,
okay,
to different people, to different cultures. So this is our luck to be open-minded for that, and yeah, to do our thing. Yeah.
So you would say there are some good things, obviously, getting to do this, but also some maybe negatives of obviously not being close
for
to your family and traveling all the
time. For sure. Because, you know, like this sacrifice that my sister had a baby girl and I couldn't go, only on FaceTime, for example. My brother had a baby boy, also the same. Like these kind of things you miss. You miss a lot. And okay, my family knows, so they accept, of course. And this is in the situation I am now. After a few years, it will change. So yeah. Also, I'm looking forward to that, to make the easy things, like the daily normal people life, I say it like this. But also, like, about the different cultures. We in Holland, we are very strict. So at the end of the month, you get paid.
Mm-hmm.
Because you do your job.
Yeah.
And in a lot of countries, it's not like this. So a few times I left the club because I said, okay, I do everything. Like I practice, I watch the videos, I take care of myself, I do the physio, I do the meetings, everything. And at the end, I'm not getting paid. It's not correct. So, of course, you know, if it's 1-2 months late, no problem, really no problem. But if you have the feeling like, okay, they don't have the money, yeah, I'm here to play my profession, but also for the money. If it's not, I can also play in Holland. So, and it's like a principle question. If this is the agreement, this is the agreement. So yeah, that's why I left some clubs, and that's why I also played for a lot of clubs. because yeah, this is how I raised by my parents, and yeah.
But it's the fundamental thing, like you said before. This is your profession. This is your job. Yeah. Like you say, you go to work, you do your job, and you get paid. So obviously, this is your profession. You expect that. That's what you're gonna.
Yeah,
get
but you're
well.
You're from Sweden. I'm from Holland. Yeah. I think it's like this.
It's
very
the
normal.
Same. Yeah, I think maybe that's why. Like you said, it depends on where you come from and where you go, and that's maybe also the thing about you traveling so much. You get to experience these different cultures that are really different from where you're from, maybe.
Really different, really different. Yeah. So it taught me a lot. And it was not always a good experience, but anyway, I learned a lot.
Yeah, learned a lot.
Yeah.
I guess both as a player and as a person then, by doing all
of this. For sure. Yeah, I agree. Mm.
And you said there as well that there are some things that obviously you miss out on being, you know, a professional athlete. Would you say then that there are a lot of sacrifice that we don't really get to see that you do have to make in order to, you know, continue to play the sport that you do love?
Yeah, because I think a lot of people underestimate that they see on the TV when we play the big tournaments, mm-hmm. when everybody's screaming for us, yelling, supporting us, but they don't see how much effort we put in. Mm-hmm. And we're like 8-9 months a year, we are alone in a different country. So this is like a lot of times you're alone, and people say like, oh, I want to be like you, but okay, we can change for 1 month, we can change for 2 weeks, our lives, and we will see if you still want to be me.
Yeah, there's a lot more that goes into it.
Yeah,
of course. So to name a few of, you know, the accomplishments and the awards that you've gotten throughout the years, because you've had time to accomplish a lot, I'm going to go through them. You won, you know, different cups and different leagues with different teams, the club teams. You've also won 3 silver medals, like you said before, at the European Championships.
Yeah.
A bronze medal at the World Grand Prix and finished 4th at the Olympics. Then as well, you were awarded the best server trophy at the 2010 World Championships. So you have been through a lot and you've been very successful with what you do, especially looking at, you know, these awards and these accomplishments. But when you look at success, is that what success means to you, these awards, or is it something else when you think of success that, okay, this defines success to me? It's like doing what I love, or it's meeting all of these people, growing as a person.
In the beginning of my career, I was really like success and focused on the goal. And if we don't reach the goal, it's not success. But it's a funny thing because last week I had a story, I had a conversation with my coach over here in Turkey, and I was talking to him like, okay, I'm really happy I still can play volleyball, and I'm really happy to be every day in the gym to work with my teammates, and because, you know, we have the same goal, and I don't know if you have this in an office, to have this kind of environment, to everybody's going like 100% every day. And this is a really special feeling. And in the beginning of my career, I didn't appreciate that so much. It was, I took it more for granted, you know, like, okay, today I'm tired. So maybe I will not give everything, you know, like I changed a lot in these kind of things, and especially the last 5-6 years. Also maybe because of my role as a captain, I knew I'm the one who had to show to my teammates that I'm always going, always. Like, I'm the first one in line who's going for the defense or to take the ball outside the volleyball court and make an impossible, seems like impossible, but still you have the ball. I'm really feeling good that I can work with people who have all the same goal. And I start to be like more thinking, okay, you know, every match is a challenge. if the opponent is better than us, they are better, but we will fight till the end, and after we will see what the result will be.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So it's more about now, maybe not appreciating it more, but looking at it in a different way, you would probably say.
Yeah. Yeah. I look at it in a different way. And also, I think some coaches are too much about the result. Like, okay, today we have to win. Mm. And I think, okay, but I know, everybody knows we have to win, you know? Like, it's more like, okay, you know, you try to do every action as good as possible. And at the end, you will see what the result or the score will be. But focus on our thing, you know? For sure we analyze the opponent. For sure we know the game plan, what we have to do. We try to do it as good as possible. And at the end, you will see who is winning.
Yeah, absolutely.
That, but this sense. Is my philosophy. Yeah. You know, I'm not a coach, but...
No, yeah. But that's cool to have you share that. And also, like you said, you know, being the team captain as well, that's probably something that comes from that as well. Like you said, being a natural leader in a position. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, and especially in the court, you know, sometimes we make like 3-4 mistakes in a row. Okay, you know, we try to make it as easy as possible. We have to get out of this rotation, and then we will see, you know? Then we will see.
Yeah.
That's all we can do. Yeah.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah.
And looking back then at everything that you've done so far, everything that you've experienced throughout your career, do you have maybe like one or a few favorite memories?
Yeah, there's the European Championship in Holland.
Okay.
When we played the semi-final against Turkey. We win 3-0, so after we were in the final. Also, I was really looking forward to the final, but we lost very big, 3-0 okay. against Russia. They outplayed us completely on every level.
Okay.
But this was really like, really... after so many years, we start to play good again when we were like really like playing good volleyball and showed it to Holland. My two titles in France with Cannes. I really liked it. My first title was in Cannes. I had my Achille tendon was torn, so I didn't play. And the second year I could play. So and it was a really tough match. One match in the playoffs, and we win 3-2. So it was really close. Yeah, actually, in every season I had something special, you know.
Yeah.
In Fenerbahce we won the title and the cup, and I played with amazing players, with the captain of Korea, the captain of Brazil, the captain of Turkey. So this was also so much to learn. Like, you had 4 captains in the court. With me, 4 captains. So how you manage this, you know? But
yeah,
it was really working good because everybody accept each other. So normally you have like, okay, one wants to be the leader, but everybody knew their job and their task in the court, and it was working perfectly. Yeah.
Yeah. So it's maybe difficult to choose one memory because obviously you have different memories from different, you know, teams and everything. Yeah. But that's a good thing.
Yeah. And I think also 2017, the European Championship was good because after 2016, our head coach, Giovanni Guidetti, mm-hmm. left from the national team. And it was a really big surprise for us. And we got a new coach. And anyway, we were again in the final. So I think this is really, really a good thing for our team. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. To come back despite, you know,
exactly,
challenges
exactly.
with that.
Yeah, yeah.
And you mentioned there as well that you had been injured throughout your career before. So if you're thinking back on your career, would you say that the injuries are some of the toughest moments that you faced, or are there other challenges that you think have been more difficult for you during your career?
And my injury was not easy. I tore my tendon in January 2014. Mm. And I think, okay, a lot of people give you advice. And they say, okay, 5-6 months, maybe maximum 9 months. So I think, okay, I'm strong. I can do this in 5-6 months. But it turned out I needed 2 surgeries. So it took me 11 months to come back in the court. So you really start to doubt. You don't have the confidence in your body like before, because my injury happened in a split second. And so you really have to trust your body again. This was difficult for me. And what I told you before, like, we in Holland, if you have an agreement, you have an agreement and you follow that. Mm-hmm. And if people don't do this, this was also really hard for me. Like, but it's, we signed for it, you know, like you agreed and I agree. And we don't why you don't follow this? So really, I had to adapt in this and I learned it through the years. Like, okay, maybe 1-2 months later, it will come, you know, like I stay more patient now than in the beginning.
Okay, so you think it's by, you know, experience of going through this that you've been able to overcome it later in your career as well, like learning how to react.
Yeah, and stay more calm in this kind of things.
Stay more calm. Okay, that makes sense. And I wanted to talk a bit about, you know, as well, the Olympics that are coming up in Tokyo, the next Olympics, because I understand with your team, obviously, after the last Olympics, then not qualifying for the Tokyo Olympics, it must have as well definitely been a challenge and something that was difficult to overcome.
Oh, yes. We had this qualification last January 2020. Mm-hmm. So it was in the middle of the club season. And I'm playing in Turkey, and Turkey qualified. So, of course, after my head coach here and one teammate, they're also in the Dutch, in the Turkish national team. So after, of course, you talk. And my coach came to me, Maret, are you okay? And I started to cry because, you know, you had everything for 2020. 2016, you had the fourth place. Now you want the medal. This is your first thing. And now we didn't even qualify. So yeah, that was extremely painful. Also, I don't know if I will watch next year on the TV, if I will watch it or not. Maybe some matches, but not everything. I think it's still too painful.
Yeah, too painful. Okay, so it's still something kind of overcoming at the moment.
And now I feel even more pain that we didn't take that medal in 2016.
Oh.
Yes.
That's, I mean, I can't relate to it, but obviously that must be something
so
that you're thinking about. Yeah.
Yeah. And maybe at that time you didn't realize that you were so close and it was, I think, the last chance.
Well, we don't know, so...
You don't know.
No, you never know what's going to happen. Yeah, we've seen this year that you can never really plan anyways. With 2020, anything can happen, so we're not going to say
exactly.
that.
Exactly. Wow, it's a really amazing, strange year.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah.
So, you know, during your career, having to face different challenges, did you ever actually think about giving up volleyball and maybe doing something else instead, or...?
No, I always think, okay, it's maybe difficult, but we will find a solution, you know, like sometimes I was not happy in the club and my agent and I, we found a solution or to change or to talk, or there was always something that after I felt good again, or when I didn't play good volleyball, sometimes you have this period as an athlete. Like, you're not always on your highest level. So you have times that you really feel like, okay, what am I doing? Can I still play volleyball? Or what I show now in the court? This is not how I am. But in these moments, I start to be more focused on myself. More on the basic things. And talk more positive to myself, because I'm the person's like, when I make a mistake, like I'm talking to myself like, okay, Maret, what are you doing now? Really, what are you doing? And I think, okay, no, this is not helping. Okay, we start back to the basic, and then it's coming back for sure, and I always did.
Yeah.
Because it's somewhere in your system, in your brain, in your muscles. It's somewhere there. So
yeah, exactly. And I wanted to ask that as well. I mean, where do you think this comes from, you know, like, where do you get this motivation from to keep going despite everything that maybe happens along the way?
Oh, to prove myself, I think.
Okay.
And to, okay, this year not, because we don't play for the public, but before, to come, that those people come to watch you play, to watch your team play. Yeah, you want to show what you can do. Yeah.
Okay.
Show what you're able of. Yeah.
Yeah. And is that like a feeling that you've had with you like throughout the years or when you were younger, what would you say like motivated you as a kid or maybe who inspired you to work hard and, you know, to give yourself the chance to get to where you are today?
I had one player, older player, when I was a child. She was also in the national team and she was also left-handed. And she was my
Okay.
example. She was also coming almost from the same city. And yeah, when I was a child also, I was fearless, you know? Everything what I wanted to do, I did, you know? I didn't think about the what happened after. No. So sometimes I think now, like, okay, Mariette, how you were as a child? It was like more like open. You didn't see the danger. You were enjoying. And I'm talking sometimes when I'm having a difficult period, I'm talking to myself like, okay, think about that child and you did it, you know? You made it what you wanted back then. Enjoy, yeah. And my mother always say, because she's not a professional athlete, she say, Mariette, you give your best and that's all what you can do. And I think, yes, mama, you're right.
Is that something that you carry with you today as well, then, in, you
Sometimes
know,
yes,
all
because
cycles?
okay, they demand a lot of us, you know, they ask a lot, like there's not room for so much mistakes because, you know, you at the end the club wants to see the result, and I understand that. But yeah, it's to be more realistic, like okay, you give your 100%, you do always your best, and more you cannot do. I'm like, yeah. To see it in a more perspective way. Yeah.
Yeah, of course. Maybe sometimes it's difficult because you said it's easy to get down on yourself, you're negative, but you kind of have
Yeah,
to take a step back and be like,
for
okay,
sure. Yeah.
perspective.
Yeah,
Yeah.
exactly.
And before as well, you said talking about, you know, that there's so much that we don't really see, you know, behind the success and everything that you achieve on TV. You talked about the mental side of sports. So within, you know, volleyball specifically and the level that you play at, how important would you say that the mental game and having the right mentality is?
Oh, it's so important, especially volleyball, because sometimes I also don't understand, like you win one set 25-10 and the next set you lose 25-15. You can lose it in a really quick way. So I think also, especially nowadays, also we have a mindfulness coach in our team, and I think that's really helpful for athletes to be more in the moment and not think about the, oh, what if I now make a mistake, then what will happen? No, you know, just stay in the present and focus on the next for the action what will come. So yeah, I think a lot of players can help this.
And you would say then that working together with a coach that works with maybe the mental game or mindfulness and stuff like that, that's something that has helped you as well?
Yeah, for sure, for sure. Yeah, this to ex especially to stay more in the moment, to not think about the what will happen after or the result or yeah, this helped me a lot. Yeah, for sure. Yeah.
And I didn't ask you about this before, but you know, obviously competing at the highest level, like both the Olympics and also you said, especially when you're competing at home, you have the home crowd like supporting you in big championships. When it comes to the mental side of that, did you ever feel any pressure that you know, really had to perform at that stage?
Yes, but I feel pressure. I always feel. And when I feel too relaxed, I'm not playing good. So I need this kind of pressure. Sometimes also it was too much. I felt too much tension. So I learned it through the years that I need a kind of tension, not too much, not too less, you know? Like I have my routine before the match and I start to feel like more like in my belly, some like, I don't know, butterflies. No, it's not the correct word, but some like, yeah, tension, I think. And I know then, okay, something is coming, something big is coming, but it's okay.
It's okay. So is that then the pressure that, you know, other people put on the team looking at the Dutch national team, or is that the pressure that you put on yourself? That's the pressure that you like.
No, it's putting on myself. It's putting on myself. And also we are like the last years, we are also more talking about it also in our national team. Like some people ask, like, are you nervous? And I said, yes, I'm nervous. And they're surprised, you know, that mm-hmm. I'm open about it or that other players are open about it. Yes, I'm nervous. But if you name it, okay, you know, nothing changed. And it helps to talk about it. Like, yes, I'm nervous. Okay, but okay. And in the warm-up, it will, because you touch the ball and you get the feeling, and it will be okay. Yeah.
Yeah, and I think it's something that people can relate to, even though they're not playing sports and it's not at the same level. They still have things in their life, you know, that, okay,
for sure.
Nervous, you know, to do, or they feel pressured about.
For sure.
Yeah, I mean, everyone has that. So from your perspective then, having that experience, what would you say is the best way to deal with those type of feelings going into big tournament?
To accept it. Okay. Really. If you fight it, for what? You know, you have these feelings and it's really completely normal. You know, I'm sure a doctor or a surgeon have also this kind of tension before a surgery. Like, this is, I think you accept, really accept. Yeah, I think this is really the key to, okay, you feel it, you continue, you know, like it's nothing happened. You know, I think acceptation is really big.
Yeah, to accept it for sure.
Yeah.
And thinking about, we spoke a bit about it before, but you know, the determination and all the hard work, that mentality that you need to make it to that level where you're at today. Is this something that you've carried with you as well from a young age? Always wanting to work hard and be determined? Yeah.
Yeah, because when I was younger, a lot of people say like, oh, you cannot make the national team because you're too small. Okay. And I heard it a lot of times. So what I did was, okay, what I need to be in a national team, I need to jump. This is my thing. Okay, I'm small, but if I jump, I can make it maybe. We will see. So I started outside my parents' home. I start to jump against the wall. All the time, block jumps. And okay, I'm also a little bit lucky because my muscles are really reactive. So I'm explosive. But that motivated me, like, okay, you know, you say that I cannot make it, but we will see at the end if I make it or not. I will give it a try, and it was a good try.
It was a good try, of course.
Yeah, so if you have some, if you're a young player, like, really, if you believe in something, go for it. Really go. Go 100%. And what people say, if you feel it, if you want to do it, go and don't give up. Really don't give up.
Okay.
Yeah.
That has been your keys kind of to get to where you are today.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. Exactly. Yeah. And it's not always easy, for sure not. Don't underestimate it. But at the end, it's all worth it.
Yeah. Absolutely. Looking back at it where you are now.
Yeah, but still, I want to win the Champions League, so.
Okay. You have a lot of things still as well that you want to do.
Maybe, yeah. So in the next years, maybe it's still possible. We'll see.
Yeah, of course. And, you know, playing volleyball your entire life, you spoke about some things that you've learned, of course, throughout the years. But overall, what type of impact do you think it's had on your life? Has it helped shaping you into the person that you are today?
Yeah, a lot. That I respect people no matter what, because you work with a lot of different cultures, so in their mindset sometimes completely different, but anyway you have to find a way to work with each other. So this I learned that you have to be open-minded for these kind of things and to find a way to work together and to treat people every person is different to handle, you know, and I learned through the years how to manage that. One girl needs a push and one girl needs just like, okay, but next time, don't worry, it will be okay, you know. So everybody is different in these things. So this taught me a lot, like how to work with people together to, at the end, to reach the same goal.
Yeah. Like you said before as well, yeah, being, you know, part of that team and having the same goal that you're working towards.
Yeah, that's really something. Yeah, it's really, people don't feel this from outside, but in a team, it's really like, you come every day, you work 6 hours every day for that goal. Yeah.
And then being where you are today and having this platform, you know, and having a lot of people following you, would you say that you see yourself as a role model for young kids out there that are looking to play sports?
Yes. Yeah, this is really stupid to say for myself, I think. But yeah, I'm aware that I'm a role model. And that people look at me, like, especially in the gym, of course. Like, what I do in the court, what I do outside the court. I like to make also fun of myself.
Okay.
About stupid things on Instagram or Twitter or this. I like so much. So I want to see, I want to show also my human side, not only the athlete side. But I'm aware of that. Yeah, I'm a role model. Yeah.
Yeah. And then in what ways do you hope that, you know, you can inspire kids or, like younger people to dream and to play sports? Like, what do you hope that they can learn from watching you and following your journey?
That if you give your 100% and if you believe in something, you can do it. Yeah. Of course, you need a little bit luck. Of course, you need to find, okay, when I was young, I found the coach who saw it in me. So she put me in the volleyball school with all the talents. So of course, if you have the right people around you, it's helping you for sure. But if you have the talent, if you want to work, if you give your 100% and you don't give up, I think you can achieve a lot.
Yeah, that's great, definitely.
Yeah.
For sure. And going back a bit again to where we are today now, because like we said, you're playing in Turkey and you are able to play right now. But I saw, of course, on Instagram that you posted a picture, I think it was in May, which was kind of like a love letter to volleyball, to your sport. Because of COVID, you know, and not being able to play. So how has this year been for you, you know, not being able to play the sport that you love, doing your job? What's it been like and how have you, you know, dealt with that?
Very strange, actually. At the end of last season, so it was March, we played the last matches here in Turkey, also already without the public.
Okay.
We play some matches without the public, I think. Then you're waiting. Until the news, what's coming, if you continue or not. My teammate Celeste Plak and I left to Holland, to back home, but it was still not sure if you continue, so maybe we had to go back to Turkey. So every day we did like this Zoom meeting with our physical coach to stay at least a little bit in shape. In May, I think it was definitely, they canceled the league. And you said, a lot of times you sit at home. We were able in Holland to meet some friends, but of course with the 1.5 meter distance. But also, you know, we had 12 weeks, I think, I was without volleyball. Also, you know, we had time to do some other things. And also I appreciated that. Like, okay, it's come as it comes and we cannot change it. Only you have to follow the rules. I enjoyed a lot with my family and with my friends. So this was really, really good. The positive side of the COVID for me. But after 4 or 5 weeks, you start to miss the game. Really start to miss the game. And also like, okay, I didn't do it for a long time. How will it be? How will I come back? You know, what will happen next season? We can play or not. So I was happy I can continue here in this club and to work again with everybody the same, but a lot of same people, and to be back on the court still without the public, but at least we can play.
So that's the most important.
And
what are your goals then, really, you know, for the future? You mentioned one there already, something that you still want to do. what are your goals, you know, short term and also maybe long term?
This Champions League, of course I want to win. But I learned also like, okay, I see every year, I will see it. Because my knees are not really like, okay, I have a lot of cartilage damage. So every 6 months I get some injections. So I know now, okay, I can have long-term goals, but I don't know. I really don't know. I cannot say it. So every season I will check how I feel, how I'm mentally, how I'm physically. And then I will decide if I continue or not.
Yeah, we'll see.
This is all I can say now, yeah, because it's like this. Yeah.
Well, that makes sense. You mentioned that already in the beginning, you know, that you're already starting to see the difference in your body of playing so much for so many years. Yeah.
Yeah. And I'm lucky that what I say, like, I'm strong. I like to do fitness also. This is really, I know it's helping my body a lot. I like to be in shape. So, we will see how long I can continue, if I still like it, if I feel good.
Yeah. And have you already had some time then to think about what you want to do once you decide to retire, or are you not thinking about it?
Yeah, I'm doing now some education, like, for because I like the, what I say, like, I like the physical part. Mm-hmm. I like the fitness, so I'm studying for that. But sometimes I also think, like, okay, maybe I can be a manager, you know, like an agent or a manager of a club, or maybe I will take some players as an agent. So everything is open. Everything is open.
Okay. Yeah. So that will be kind of to see how you feel as well when that time comes.
Maybe I start my own podcast.
Yeah. Who knows? No, but absolutely. I mean, there's so many things you can do.
Maybe. You yeah. know? So... Yeah,
with your experience everything and everything. Open. Yeah. Yeah. You never know.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So we'll have to wait and see for that. Yeah. And then outside of volleyball, I mean, you said you don't have that much free time, but when you do have some time off, what, you know, do you like to do?
I like to go the simple things, like to go for breakfast or brunch or watch some movie. Nowadays I'm reading more books because I think I need it more. like hang out with friends, the people I love. Yeah, this I like a lot.
Okay. Yeah. So a lot of different stuff.
Yeah. And also, you know, I miss sometimes to go out to dance with the friends, to party, especially now this year. It was not possible, I think, all from February, March, it already stopped. So it's not that I party every week, but sometimes, you know, like, I like to go out. Yeah,
something different from what you do every
week. I like to dance, yeah.
Okay, that's really cool.
Yeah.
And you said now that, you know, you started reading a bit more. What's the last thing that you maybe read, or maybe not read, but it could be like a TV show or a movie or anything that, you know, you thought was really inspiring and that you think that everyone should check out?
Yeah, that was when I was in Holland, I watched The Last Dance.
Oh, yes.
With Michael Jordan. Yeah, and this was really inspiring for me. And I saw The Playbook. This was like 2 months ago, I think, The Playbook, about coaches, how they treat their players. I was really, and especially this tennis coach, I don't know, the coach of Serena Williams.
Yeah.
Patrick something. And how we approach the tennis players. Really, really amazing. Yeah. Yeah. And I start to follow him now on Instagram. And sometimes he has some quote. And I think, oh, okay, I have to remember that. This is good. This is good.
Yeah. Oh, cool. That's funny. I actually watch both of them as well. So I know what you're talking about.
I can agree. It's cool, right?
Yeah, it's super cool. It's interesting. It's also kind of, you know, getting this insight to what's going on behind.
Yeah. Yeah, and especially tennis, you know, it's so individual. You're so out there alone on the court. And also in the match, he cannot coach her.
Yeah.
So everything has to be in the practice or outside. Yeah.
Yeah, that's great. Really cool. Yeah, for sure. Yeah. I agree with you. That's something everyone should watch. For sure.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah. And I have one more question for you. You've obviously already given a lot of advice and, you know, said a lot of great things throughout this conversation, but we always ask this question because obviously our podcast is about, you know, sharing the unique stories of athletes and showing that obviously everyone has a different journey, a different story. So if you could add something else to what you said before, if you want to kind of, you know, reinforce that again, what's the one advice that you would give to someone who has big dreams and who are listening to this podcast episode but don't really know how to make their dreams a reality?
I think you have to stay true to yourself. Because, and that's really difficult as a young player because you got a lot of advice. But I remember one moment, I was in the young national team. I was 15 years old. And in the young national team, I play opposite. And in my club, I play a different position. And I remember the coach told me, like, okay, if you want to be in the European Championship qualification, also in the club, you have to play as an opposite because I need you there. And I knew in that time, I'm not the opposite in volleyball is like in general a tall person who score every high ball, you know, and I knew I'm not this kind of player. So I said, okay, coach, you know, this is your opinion. I'm more like a position four player, what I am now. Okay, if this is your decision, it will be your decision. Okay, I will work for the next 3-4 months. And at the end, you decide. At the end, I was in the list and I was in the starting six in the young national team as an opposite. So I was 15 years old. It was difficult to say this, but in that time, I knew already, like, okay, this is not my position. But of course, you know, if in the young national team, I play everything because I want to play. Doesn't matter. But in the future, I knew, like, okay, I will not make the high level, top level as an opposite. I will be as in position four. So my message is, like, if you feel something that this is the right way, go for that and stay true to yourself.
That's great, really.
Yeah.
No, that's really important. I do agree with you on that, that you have to find what works for you. It's not what's the best from other people's perspective.
Exactly. Because in that moment, the coach needed me as an opposite. I understand. But I knew, like, if I want to continue in the high level volleyball, I need to be a position four player.
Yeah, something different for you.
Yeah.
Sure. Well, thank you so much, Marit. I wanted to say that. It's been a pleasure.
I liked your questions.
That's great. Thank you. No, we really appreciate, you know, having you on the podcast. It's been great. And cool. We know that everyone listening will definitely have a lot of good things to look forward to when listening to the episode. So thank you so much for coming on. We really appreciate it.
Yes, you're welcome. I liked it a lot. Yeah.
Thank you.